creating it. We're 60 strong, and love to sing, and hope you enjoy the concert. Make sure that you turn the volume off on your phones, please, and we'll get started. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. about this, to welcome our new accompanist this year, our collaborative pianist, who just graduated from UConn. We're lucky enough to snag her before everyone else in the state takes her away from us. Emma Bocciareli. Oftentimes I have really bad ideas, but once in a while I have really good ones. And one of the good ones I had was when I had the idea to ask my wife, Michelle, to sort of conduct a few pieces on the concert. Our approaches to working with the choir are totally different, so instead of getting just one approach, the choir gets approached from two different people, which is great. She has different feelings about the kind of music she likes to program, so it gets a little different style to it. And third off, she's just fantastic at what she does. She's sort of the all-around performer, I'm sure the choir agrees. She does the technology stuff, she conducts the choir, she sings the alto section, she keeps me from screwing up. It's all really good stuff. So I'd like to introduce my wife, the director of the crowd, Michelle.
Thank you.
lot to do with what we think about singing, etc. The second part is stories. You may or may not know this, back in the day, all music was sacred, long time. But then somewhere along the line, secular music started showing up. And what's cool about why sacred music is mainly about edifying and giving us faith and enlarging our spirits, secular music, folk music, is about telling stories. Stories that include all sorts of the human experience. Stephen Chapman, about 1985, I believe it was, wrote these songs called Songs of the Prospector, which were five pieces of music written by poetry, text by George Winkler from his diaries. George Winkler was an old prospector, rough kind of guy out in British Columbia, Canada, back in the 19th century, mid-19th century. And in his journals, he wrote these about these characters that he met, the scout, which is the first one. And then he wrote about this guy who was in love with a girl who was far away from him, roses I send to him. And then he wrote about this guy named Connie, who was so loud and obnoxious and full of hot air that he reminded him of a calliope, which is a loud and obnoxious and full of hot air instrument. So we hope you enjoy our three songs from Prospector, and please hold your applause to Rebel Love.
Yellow leggings wear, his clothes a little shopping like a nerd. I just wanted to read to you, I'm going to read in the program too, but I just thought the text of this is so beautiful. And the feeling of the song is so beautiful. I hope we can convey that to you. Like, just the beginning line is timely and just important. I dreamed of rain and the rain came, soft and easy, sweet and clear. I dreamed of rain and the rains came, and peace spread over.
Thank you.
So the centerpiece of the program is this Alway Something Sings. It's an Emerson poem that really struck me, as I said earlier, when I heard it this summer. The beginning text sort of sets up the, what I feel is pretty profound about it. It sounds from all things old. It sounds from all things young. From all that's fair, from all that's foul. Always, always, something sings. So the choir tells this story, and Suzanne, who's going to be singing the solo, represents that no matter what's going on in our lives, there's always something that can kind of keep us going forward, keep us living, keep us hoping, and keep us having faith. So I hope you enjoy Always Something Sings.
Let me go where I will.
started. And I, in my mind, ahead of time, for this song, I'm thinking, like, I need, like, a kind of a young voice for this solo, because it represents innocence, it represents youth, and I need to work. And I'm like, I don't know if we're going to have a solo, so the choir can do it, I'm going to hire someone, I don't know what to do. And these three girls and their mom walk in, and I think, if I remember correctly, Brittany, correct me if I'm wrong, they started walking out, and then I think we got an eye test, and she said, can my girl sing in the choir? And literally in my mind, I was saying, like, well, I don't know. Never had three middle school girls in the choir before. I'm from the river, you know? So, and then but they come in the choir, and they sit with the choir, and then at some point, she sang the solo for me, and I was like, it really was faint. It was really fake that these three middle school girls, we've never had a middle school girl sing in the choir, and this girl with this angelic voice and this confidence was in here, perfect for that solo. So let's hear it for Susan. Kind of coming to a set. So it gives the choir a chance to sit down, take a little bit of a break. Opportunity to hear somebody different and elongate the program a little bit. So it's a win-win-win. I've been trying to get Jermaine down here for three or four years. I'm very fortunate. I sing in the Congregational, which has just many, many amazing singers in it. And Jermaine is certainly at the top of that. He's a force of nature as a soloist, as a choir member, and most importantly, as a human being. So he's going to do three songs for you, and we hope you enjoy the artistry of Jermaine Woodard, Jr.
So, as I was sitting over there, I had almost forgotten about the theme of this concert, and then I realized I probably should communicate that to you all, what I thought about for this set. And I'm going to keep it really simple. The first song is Singing to be Heard. The second is Singing to be Seen, to be Felt. And the third, I would liken it to Singing to be Loved, therefore Singing to be Alive. Though we all want to feel loved and feel connected. And I don't want to give you a simple recital set. I want to connect with all of you. So let's go on this journey together. Close your eyes, sing, or maybe not sing. But close your eyes and just feel this moment with me. And I would also ask that you hold the applause until the end, because I just want to do it with them and just go through and give you something different.
Thank you. Thank you.
And
Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming today. Before we end with our closing benediction, I'll just take a photo copy of that piece, but hopefully you'll understand why I did it. Sort of a dessert at this whole concert, kind of clumsy last final thought. But before we do that, I want to thank Emma one more time for Accompanist. And what's great about choir, it's great about the Shoreline Chorale in particular, is two things. Number one, choir is the easiest way to go from being a consumer of music to being a participant in music. I mean, you just can't pick up a tuba and go play in the band. That's a sort of skill. But this choir, particularly Shoreline Chorale, since we're going to do auditions, is a y'all come sing and we're just going to have fun, we're going to make some good music. So if you haven't sung for 20 or 30 years, come and join us. Lots of people haven't. And the other thing I like about the chorale is a lot of choirs do like one particular work or a larger work. What I like about the chorale, which you might want to consider, is we can sing different songs, all the 15, the 12 songs we did today. Maybe you hate 8 of them, but you like 4, and that's pretty good. So we like to do a variety of stuff, and we're open to everybody, so we hope you'll consider joining us, and we start January 10th. Thank you for coming. Song, we send you the best our hearts can do. May health and good fortune attend you as long as you shall live.
May health and good fortune. but without them, it wouldn't be they've been fun to work with, we enjoy it, and some people who are joining us, they look like a wizard, not a bit of a call. And right now, I'd like to hear from the other people. For Russ and Michelle, thank you very much for all of your help. And